thank you both so much for coming. I'm very excited to be here. As Ben said, this is really right in my wheelhouse, all of the stuff that culminates in David Mack's wonderful graphic novel, The Community Series. It's about ventral spirits, it's about Japanese culture, it's comic books, which I've been a big fan of since I was in my early teens. And you would think with all these cross currents of interesting subject matter that I'm personally deeply invested in, that I would have actually read David Mack's Kabuki before I participated in this project to give a presentation. But I actually hadn't. It was one of these things that everybody, practically, it feels like, you know, you have a thing that everybody's always saying to you, oh, have you read that thing? You would love it. And you say, oh yeah, you're one of many people to tell me that. And it's on my list of things to read, you know, this very long list. So one of the lovely things about being part of this lecture series was it got bumped to the top of the queue, and I got to read this beautifully complex and compelling story that I'm going to talk with you about now. So you say you have not actually seen the production, and so what I'm going to try to do here is kind of walk a fine line between making sure that what I'm talking about makes sense to you within the context of the narrative without giving too many spoilers away, because you don't want to ruin the ending of it. Kabuki, as I said, is a really complex and compelling read, not just because it is visually stunning and in some places breathtakingly beautiful, but because it is about so many interesting concepts, the story itself. It tackles ideas about social and governmental corruption. It tackles ideas about the exploitation of vulnerable populations. It is a story of self-discovery. It is a hero's journey. But most noticeably, perhaps, it is a revenge story. It is a story about vengeance. And even more so about the nature of vengeance and about the nature of vengeance as a spirit, as vengeful ghosts. So, looking at something cool. This is a cover to the prelude issue of Circle of Blood, which was called Fear the Reaper, and it was released a couple of months before 1994. So there are four main characters who kind of intersect with these themes about vengeance. Right. The titular character, Kabuki, who you see represented here, is our main character. She is opposed with a man named Kai, who is the son of her benefactor, a man who throughout most of the story goes by the name of the General. Right. I'm not actually going to spend too much time talking about the General, but his relationship to Kai and his relationship to Kabuki is kind of important foreknowledge to give you here. So Kai is the son of the General. They are both warriors, they're military men, they participate in Japan's war. Specifically, it references Second World War, even though this is a story set in the future. You have all these characters whose lifespans are kind of augmented by new technology. So you can suspend your disbelief a little bit about some of these people who are hundreds of years old, it seems like. or into their hundreds, at any rate. The General, while he is stationed overseas during World War II, he engages comfort women to entertain his troops. And one of the comfort women is Kabuki's mother, whose name is Tsukiko. The General falls in love with Tsukiko. His son Kai resents this and brutally attacks Tsukiko. Ultimately, his attack results in her death. And so Kabuki, the character, she is driven by this desire for revenge on this person who ruined her life, who killed her mother, and who, in fact, later on, attacked her and scarred her face, right? So when our story begins, right, Kabuki is acting as a government agent. She works for a shadow organization called the No, and she's tasked with high-level assassinations that maintain a very delicate balance between the Japanese government and the crime syndicates that kind of run the economy. At the same time, Kai is on the verge of consolidating power as the preeminent crime syndicate corporation in Japan, and the No wants him to be stopped. So these oppositional roles of Kabuki and Kai, not to mention their own grotesque personal history, put them on the path to confrontation, and that is basically the kind of thrust of the story, just to give you a little background. But I do want to take a step back now and return to the topic of vengeance. As I said, Fuki is most notably a story about vengeance and a story about the nature of vengeful ghosts. And knowledge of vengeful ghost lore, particularly obviously Japanese vengeful ghost lore, is intrinsic to the narrative of Circle of Blood. And I think we'll enrich kind of your understanding of the story. So, the chief thing to remember about vengeful ghosts, Japanese vengeful ghosts, is that they are terrifying. They do not come back to tell family members about where they hid very important financial documents behind the headboard of the bed that are going to save the house from bankruptcy. They do not come back to share a heartwarming moment with someone who was not present at the deathbed. They do not come back to wander the paths of gardens or sit peacefully in rooms that they loved while they were alive. When they come back because they are driven by some unhappiness or some brutal experience that occurred during their lifetime, and they want to exercise this feeling of malevolence and rage that persists in them after death. So when they come back, it's not pretty. In contrast to the typically diaphanous Western ghost, right, our idea of kind of a Western spirit, it's see-through, it's flimsy, you have all these movies where there's a very touching moment between someone who's alive and someone who's dead and they can't touch because the hand goes through. The Japanese ghost in some ways is really more like a corpse than a spirit. As Dr. Timon Screech, who is an ukiyo-e expert, an expert of Edo period art, Edo period is from about 1603 to 1868, so from the 17th to the 19th centuries. He describes Japanese ghosts in this manner, saying that rising up from the darkness, they reanimate themselves with the flame of their passion. This makes them partially human again, reinvested with their original mind and something of their former body too, scars, blood, and all. However, despite the fact that they are reanimated with their original mind, they are absolutely not rational creatures. This irrationality is a kind of fundamental component to them. They may seek a specific target as an object of their anger or their obsession or their need for revenge, but they are just as likely to attack anyone who has the misfortune to cross their paths, be in the wrong place at the wrong time. Don't go out between 1 and 3 o'clock in the morning. That's a very dangerous time to be out, according to Japanese superstition. That's when they are most likely to be out and about. Now, this particular concept of vengeful ghosts is one that developed over time, and sadly, an overview of the entire history of the development is really outside the scope of this talk. But I do want to emphasize two kind of basic points about this. The first is that the ideas about the nature of these spirits and what these creatures were, how they operated, there were many different ideas, and they had many different ways of referring to these creatures. You have Goryeo, August spirits, which are often is an appellation that would be applied to the ghosts of emperors or famous statesmen who had to be revered for one reason or another. Onryo, which is a more kind of explicit vengeful spirit, combines its characters of they on the right hand side, yo, which means spirit, and on, which means an anger. Yure, which is kind of like your garden variety ghost and kind of what we understand as ghosts. Yokai, which is a very broad category but includes ghosts, monsters, goblins, devils, all kinds of phantoms and specters. And then the more broad mononoke, which means the spirit of things. And if you've ever, Hayao Miyazaki had that Mononoke Hime, or Princess Mononoke. That's the phrase that he's referring to. And Mononoke is a very broad moniker that covered basically anything you could imagine. It covered from the ghosts of deceased people all the way to the spirits of the directed will and the spirit of inanimate objects, which got up to all kinds of interesting trouble. There's a very interesting story that dates from the Heian period, so that's between the 9th and 12th centuries, about a nobleman who's going home late at night. He's out during that taboo, 1 to 3 o'clock, when you're not supposed to be out. And he sees a jar in the road ahead of him, just a little like a wine jug rolling along. And it rolls under the gate of this very elegant mansion. And the next day he hears how the daughter of the house has succumbed to an illness in the night, right, which is attributed to the malevolent will of the spirit of that jar. So this idea of what a ghost was, right, was very broad, for lack of a better term. But one defining characteristic was that they were extremely dangerous in this period. Now, what we consider to be ghosts and these ideas of ghost stories and a visual iconography that describes ghosts becomes much more standardized once you reach the Edo period and you come into that what we call the early modern period beginning in the 17th century. And this happens for a number of reasons. Most likely, a lot of people feel most likely because after the unification of Japan, which took place in the 16th century by Oda Nobunaga, Toyotomi Hideyoshi, and Tokugawa Ieyasu, Japan finally stopped being a volatile place. You know, it was not subject to constant warfare any longer. And you had the development of printing presses, which spread information, which disseminated information widely and much more democratically. And so ghost stories, ghost prints, plays, all became wildly popular at this point in time. And ideas about what constituted a ghost also proliferated. As you can see here, one of the main ways that ideas about what ghosts look like was passed through ukiyo-e prints like this one by Toyohara Kunichika. This is actually not an illustration of a ghost per se, but it is an illustration of a kabuki actor playing the role of a very famous ghost named Okikuku in a play known as The Plate Mansion. And so prints like this that depicted these supernatural creatures gave the broad population of Japan a set visual image of what a ghost looked like in comparison with a living human. So the iconography, and I'm using these two examples here. On the left-hand side, you have what is simply just titled a ghost or a painting of a ghost. It's by Iijima Koga. It's a hanging scroll. And on the right, you have another illustration of a story, right, a famous story, The Ghostly Tale of the Wetner's Tree by Ito Seiyu. And again, another hanging scroll. And these two scrolls and a number of other scrolls that are in this PowerPoint are all held in the collection of Zen Shoan Temple in Tokyo, which if you ever have plans to travel to Tokyo and you are there in August, the Zen Shoan Temple opens up their vast collection of, I think it's something 40 or 50 hanging scrolls that are all of ghosts. And it's truly an amazing spectacle. But these two together give a very good sense of what the standard iconography is for a ghost from the Edo period on. The first thing to notice, especially because we are going to be talking about this a lot, is that ghosts do not have feet. You notice at the bottom here, their bodies, they kind of elongate into this sort of misty space where their feet are completely not shown. They have limp hands. Usually if they're holding on to something, as this ghost is here, like this ghost is holding on to a baby, but you notice he's really kind of grasping it more with his arms or his wrists, this ghost. He's not really holding it with the hands. You don't see strong, powerful grip in the hands of a ghost. It's usually they'll hold them kind of like this or sort of in like this. There's this image, this kind of sense of no power within the hands. They have pale skin. It'll be white or bluish. Blue in particular, kabuki actors who portrayed ghosts, their faces would be painted blue, and that would be a strong marker of the fact that they were not alive. They had long, unkempt hair. This is a particular characteristic. In contrast to ukiyo-e prints of beautiful women, like courtesans, geishas, young daughters of samurai families who would have these very beautiful, elaborate coiffures, right, with tortoiseshell hairpins and combs and all these kinds of things. Gos typically do not have that kind of elaborate hairstyle, and that's one of the significant markers of someone who is not alive, is this kind of crazy, unkempt hair. And then, of course, ragged clothing, usually a white or a blue robe, which would be associated with burial, mark them as undead. Now, of course, there are always exceptions to every rule, so you do see images like this one, the singer, Ghost of the Blind Street Singer, which is by Hiroshige, which doesn't incorporate all of these elements. You notice there is a kind of remnants of this elaborate coiffure in this woman, although you do note that, well, it's kind of hard to see from this, but you can see these kind of tendrils sort of hanging around, framing her face. There's a sense that it is coming apart. It's not completely down, but it is coming apart. And of course, she has these other characteristics. Her feet, they're lost in this kind of almost swamp-like rush of water at the bottom. She's wearing these loose kind of ragged robes. She carries a biwa under the arm, but again, her hands are very limp. And of course, she has this real sickly pallor, right? Obviously not a healthy living person. Now, David Mack, who wrote and illustrated Kabuki, is very, very well aware of all of these characteristics. He makes reference to the nature of Japanese ghost stories and their ubiquity in Japanese art and theater in a conversation that takes place between Kabuki here and her nemesis Kai on the right in issue number 5. So Kai is kind of describing this, and he is associating Kabuki's quest for vengeance against him with these traditional stories, traditional Japanese ghost stories. If you note, the Japanese ghost is much different from its Western counterpart. Most noticeable among the differences is that, with the exception of the occasional historical figure, Japanese ghosts are mainly female. And speaking of someone who wrote a PhD on vengeful spirits and their representation in art, he's pretty much spot on here. Aside from historical figures, the main vast majority of vengeful ghosts are women, especially in the Edo period. They outnumber the men 10 to 1. He goes on to say they're wrong or enraged women, like the famous Oiwa and Yotsuya ghost story, who in all versions, Kabuki, film, and TV is bent on exacting revenge against the man who wronged her. Then he goes on to speak a little bit more about the underlying themes of the Japanese ghost story, saying the Japanese ghost compelled by love or revenge is a being fueled by passion. For the Japanese, this passion is irrational and therefore a truly frightening spectacle. But passion is also drama, and that is why the Japanese ghost has lent itself to the art so well. Kabuki plays are almost entirely about ghosts, as is the no drama, which Ben talked about last week. And this is in 1995 that David Mack is writing this, so I feel it's very noteworthy that he points this out, because this is before the big Japanese horror boom, the J-horror boom that took place in the late 90s and early 2000s that made vengeful spirits like Sadako here on the left hand, Kayako, so Sadako from The Ring, Kayako from Ju-on the Grudge. Note that on, that's the same on as in Onryo, the vengeful spirit, made these household names, as well as lesser known films like Seance by Kurosawa Kiyoshi, and this truly bad movie called Ghost System. Really hilariously idiotic B movie about trying to capture ghosts, and obviously that's like a really fantastic idea. But you can see that real explicit use of the iconography here. It used digital effects to remove the feet, and we'll talk a little bit more about other ways that a lack of feet is illustrated. So David Mack relies primarily on two components of ghost iconography to convey character cues. The first is the lack of feet that I've been going on and on about, and the second is unkempt hair, that long, kind of out of control hair. We'll look at his use of footlessness first. Now, historically, the effect has been achieved in a variety of ways. Edo period kabuki performances that pioneered the effect actually used rope pulleys and costuming to make the actors who were portraying ghosts appear to float across the stage. They would actually be carried by these vast pulley systems with, you know, their robes kind of hanging down, and probably they pulled up their legs a little bit. Now, printmakers and painters, as we have seen, created the effect through visual cues that included fog, mist, water, and the use of extremely long robes. This is a beautiful woodblock print by Sukiyoki Yoshitoshi, one of my favorites. He's a late Edo, early Meiji period artist. And this is actually the painter Maruyama Okyo, who was also very well known for painting ghosts, being surprised by a ghost actually coming out of the painting that he has created, which is so realistic that this hideous creature has actually jumped out of it and given him quite a scare. Now, contemporary cinema, as we discussed, achieved the effect through CGI or through motion acting. One of my favorites is this beautiful sequence from the original Ring. You can see the way she's walking. What they actually did was they had a kabuki-trained actor. And what the actor did was the actor walked back, was filmed walking backwards, and then they played the sequence forward to create this very ungainly gait. And this is a thing that you see a lot in cinemas where they decide not to remove the legs with CGI because it's expensive and doesn't always look great, where the ghost will either crawl or have a very strange gait, which again indicates this sense of a lack of connection to the ground, a lack of grounding that is one of the hallmarks of ghosts. Now, David Mack, he uses a combination of traditional art techniques and costuming to achieve this effect. Kabuki is often seen walking through misty rain or smoke. As you see here, these are two images, I believe, from issue 4, where you can see she is walking, or she seems to emerge from this smoke, right where her legs at the bottom, they have disappeared, they're just completely whited out. And even when she's depicted in full body, as she is in several places, she typically remains fragmented by the adoption of thigh-high black boots that evoke full-body black robes that are worn by bunraku puppeteers and that signal negative space in the mind of the audience. And what I mean by this is, I have an example here. This is an example of a bunraku puppet performance where you have three puppeteers who operate this massive puppet. The main puppeteer here is responsible for operating her right hand and her face, the puppet's face. And as the senior member, he is allowed to have his head uncovered. The other two puppeteers respectively operate the left-hand side of the body and then the feet. And the audience treats these men as if they are not there. Right? The focus of the action is the puppet. The puppet is the performer. And this is all, it all is all treated completely as negative space. And you can see a similar figure if you go back to this cover that we started with at the beginning. Because in a black and white graphic novel, it can be kind of hard to tell exactly what the colors are intended to be. But very clearly, David Mack was conscientious about this distinction between the red of Kabuki's costume, which symbolizes the rising sun, and then these black boots, which form a stark break between the whiteness of her upper legs and then this black negative space down below. And this choice is reflected in the costuming of Shadow Box Live's production. They adhere very closely to David Mack's visual preferences. And so you can see here in this screenshot of Amy Lay portraying Kabuki, she is wearing the same costume with these black boots. And she wears these black boots throughout. And this serves to kind of recreate this sense of fragmentation in her body. Now, as I've said before, the lack of a ghost's foot, it symbolizes this disconnection that they have from to the realm of the living. They are not attached to the earth. They are separate from it. They are removed. And thus, this fragmentary depiction of the characters, right, their disconnection via visual cues suggests their connection from the world as shadow agents working for this secret government organization, and also as victims of trauma, which is a name component of the story. So Kabuki is understood as a ghost within two contexts. First is her status as an agent of the no, which is referred to in text as an army of ghosts. And you see them in the graphic novel. They're depicted periodically as these chess figures, where you can see kind of their full body costumes, all of which are very elaborate, and which serve to divide and cut up their body in strange, uncanny ways. When you see some of these no agents in close up, you see that they feature similar characteristics to Kabuki. Ice here on the left has a kind of biomechanical suit that she's wearing. Tiger Lily and Snapdragon have the same kind of black boots that run all the way up their legs and that serve to kind of cut them off from the ground. But Kabuki is also understood as a ghost in conflation with the ghost of her mother, which, as I mentioned before, the four primary figures in this drama are Kabuki's mother, Tsukiko, her benefactor, the general, who was in love with Tsukiko, Kabuki, who is Tsukiko's daughter, obviously, and Kai, the general's son. So throughout the text, Kabuki specifically refers to herself as having been remade in her mother's image by Kai's assault on her, right? Kai assaulted her mother and killed her, and then when Kabuki was maybe 9 or 10, Kai assaulted her. And you see this, the visual elements. She's shown in the same pose, on the same page as her mother. Her mother, who not only died and whose spirit haunts the major characters, but who also portrayed a ghost in this image here on the left. This is while she is still alive, but she is acting in a Kabuki drama, portraying a ghost. And her costume is designed to reflect this, right? She has this very long robe, and her legs are obscured. And again, in this picture, the way Kabuki is framed on the page, her legs are also cut off. Now, Kabuki's mother is portrayed with traditional ghost iconography both before. This is right after her attack. You can see she is framed in such a way that her legs, obviously she still has them, but they are drawn up in such a way to make it appear as if she is legless. And of course her hair, which in the previous image, let's go back, she's typically shown like this with a lovely elegant hairdo. After her attack, right, when she has been violated, she takes on these kind of ghost-like characteristics. So before and then after, in representations of her, where she is kind of imagined by her daughter, right? She's imagined in this context again, this lack of legs, and this long kind of flowing hair. Sorry, I kind of jumped a little out of order there. So, moving to the other main character, Kai. He also displays elements of ghost iconography. Notably, the first time we see him, not in flashback, but the first time we see him kind of appear in the chronology of this story, he exhibits a scraggly, unkempt, long-haired visage. Right? You see a wildness to him, right? There is, it's like, I don't know, he hasn't shaved, he probably hasn't washed, who knows what's going on. And this kind of wildness and this lack of control is in direct contrast to how he's portrayed in flashback sequences, where you see him either dapper with his hair kind of very lovely combed back, and he's obviously keeping good hygiene, or if he, during his time as a military man, where he has the very standard shortcut military hair cut. And though he cleans himself up somewhat after this first appearance, right, you see him later, he dresses himself appropriately, I guess we could say, but he never really sheds this look of wildness, right? He's still got that 5 o'clock shadow going on, he's still got kind of this crazy hair going on, and so he has a before and an after, right, that is represented here. He has a symbolic life and a symbolic death, right, earlier when he was looking around. And this is a change that's noted specifically by characters in the text. So it's something that David Mack wants you to notice. One of Kai's compatriots, a man named Johnny Yamamoto, he says, "I dig the name up at Kai, but your hair looks kind of weird." And another member of the gang will talk and says, yeah, we heard you were dead, right? The implication being, well, who's to say that he's not emotionally? Again, these visual markers are ever present in Shadowbox Live adaptation. where you have these wonderful subtle nuances that are captured in the costuming of these characters. You have J.T. Walker here portraying Kai. You can see he has this kind of long, scraggly at the bottom, kind of scruff, but he hasn't had a really good haircut in a while. I love this. His costume is particularly, it's one of my favorite things. His tie is kind of off over here to the side. Like, what's going on there? But it's just ever so slightly off-kilter. It's just ever so slightly irrational. And that serves to convey the kind of irrationality of this character, this out-of-placeness. So these various juxtapositions between Kabuki and Kai, right, here we have Kai over here, again, hair flying, walking Kabuki right in her boots, her legs cut off. These juxtapositions pose a number of questions for us as we are reading this and as we are watching the play, right? Who, in fact, in this is really a ghost? What is a ghost, right? What does it mean to be alive? What does it mean to live? What does it mean to be dead? What does it mean to be a force for vengeance? What does it mean to be consumed by your passions, right? And this consumption, which both of them are subject to, right? Is that living or is that death? What does it mean to be unable to let go, as neither of them can let go, of the dead, of the living, of a grudge? These questions and their answers play out visually across the story, and they're tied to the specificity in the elements of ghostliness that David Mack has chosen to use for each of these characters, as each is in each case, the iconography that he's relying on signifies something different. In the case of Kabuki and the agents of the No, fragmentation and disconnection, which is embodied in the way their bodies are portrayed, right, with their lack of grounding, with the fragmentation of their costuming. And in the case of Kai, irrationality that is embodied in his unkempt hair and in his disarrayed clothing. And it's important that thing about the disarray of Kai's attire and the disarray of his appearance. When you contrast it with Kabuki's mother, right, we'll look at this image again. This is an image of Kabuki's mother after death. She has a number of these characteristics, right? She's legless. She's shown long hair. Her hair is kind of spilled out. But it is not unkempt, right? It's really actually rather beautiful the way it falls. There's a kind of silky glossiness to it that's captured in these lovely highlights throughout. And that indicates that while she's clearly a ghost, she is not out of control in the way Kai is. And this is because Tsukiko is not a traditional vengeful ghost. The way that Tsukiko, or her memory, works on Kabuki is, in fact, not Japanese so much as Shakespearean. If you recall what we talked about earlier, right, the fundamental characteristic of the Japanese ghost is that it is truly a terrifying specter. It is violent, it is irrational, it is dangerous, right? Vengeful spirits do their own dirty work. They don't require their children to go after the people who have wronged them like Hamlet's father did. Indeed, practically the only time a Japanese ghost really comes back for a good cause is when they feel the need to care for or safeguard a child. There's a whole class of Japanese ghosts, mainly female again, although there are some male examples. They're called ubume, and basically what they are women who, they died in childbirth and they come back from the grave to nurse a child, or they die out in the wilderness and they come back from the grave to make sure that their child gets back to civilization, right? That's really kind of the only, I hesitate to say only, but one of the only really rare instances of a Japanese ghost kind of coming back and doing a solid. Now, this atypicality of Tsukiko as a ghost is highlighted in the prominent usage of a recurring image that you see here, And you're going to see it quite a lot in the show. They use it a lot as well. And this draws not from Japanese ghost iconography, but from the Western-style portraits of Meiji and Taisho period yoga painters, like Kuroda Seki here on the left, and Fujishima Takeji. And yoga painters were interested in working in Western-style materials and utilizing Western-style aesthetics and facilities. And so you can see these are oil on canvas paintings rather than the more traditional ink and color on paper or silk. And they incorporate this kind of thin over fat layering and this very painterly quality. You can see particularly in this portrait by Fujishima Takeji. You'll also notice there are similarities between the dress of Tsukiko in this image here to the Kuroda Seki, right? She's wearing a very similar kind of kimono with a very similar the way it is kind of popped in the back. Her hairstyle here with this kind of sort of up swept look, again, the same here. And so you see, again, here, David Mack is making reference to these Japanese painters. But like all elements, he turns them into service of his own story. In particular, he's taking these painterly strokes of the Japanese yoga masters and turning them into a representation of the night sky, right? Where these beautiful broad strokes of oil on the canvas become the shooting stars in the darkness as Kabuki looks up and sees sees or imagines or envisions this vision of her mother's face, which has become the moon, right? Which, of course, her name Tsukiko means daughter of the moon. So again, this is a very deliberate, very specific choice that David Mack has made to pay homage to these Japanese artists, but also tell his own story. Brings us to the last image that I'm going to talk about today, because I want to return to this, the importance of specificity in his work and the deliberate choices that he is making as an artist to reference other artists. This is a very famous print. Again, it's an illustration of a story, The Tale of Genji, right, which I think if you're familiar with Japanese culture at all, maybe even not so familiar with Japanese culture, you probably have heard of the world's oldest novel, Tale of Genji, written by Murasaki Shikibu around the year 1000. The Tale of Genji tells the story of the lives, loves, and losses of the shining Prince Genji, right, who is the son of an emperor of a lesser family and who is removed from the imperial line of succession, which is something that happened very often because emperors tended to be very prolific in their output of offspring, and something had to be done or chaos would ensue. And so throughout the story, Genji meets and falls in love with and has assignations with a number of women. And the two that are the focus of this particular story, the Yugao chapter of the Tale of Genji, are of course the eponymous Yugao, who is portrayed here as a ghost, and the Lady Rokujo, who is another paramour of Genji's. So in this chapter, Genji plans a secret tryst with this beautiful young woman, Yugao, and Rokujo, who suspects him of infidelity. She doesn't know for sure because he pawns her off with an excuse. And I'm going to take a moment just to tell you one of my favorite facts of early Japanese history, which is the Taoist calendar used to be used to calculate unlucky days, right? Days that were unlucky to do this activity or go this place. And one of the things that it could be unlucky to do was go in a certain direction. So you would have a day, say, you know, the sixth day of the fourth month, where it was unlucky to go north. And so if you lived south of the palace, which you did because of the way the towns were laid out with the palace in the north and everything else south, if you had business in the palace on a certain day, but it was dangerous to go north, you had to plot this very elaborate route to make sure that you could get to the palace on the day you were supposed to be there without having to go north. Well, what happens is numerous Japanese men adopt this as a reason why they can't go see their girlfriends or their wives. because they really want to be somewhere else or they want to see someone else. And so stories written by women like The Tale of Genji and diaries written by women like the diary, The Gossamer Years, written by Michi Tsuneya's mother, they are rife with these records of men saying, oh baby, I would really love to come and see you, but like I can't go north. You know, it's not you. I want to be with you, but like I couldn't come and see you go north. And the women going, he's a liar. He's a darn liar. Right? And that's basically what happens in this chapter. Genji tells Rokujo he can't come and see her for some stupid excuse. She believes he's a liar. In her rage, in her jealous rage, she is so overcome with fury that her spirit leaves her body, travels around until it finds Genji, finds the woman he's with, and murders her. And this is very, very, this is very, very significant, because here's the image from issue one of David Max Kabuki. As you can see, it is a very, very explicit copy of this particular image by Sophia Hoshitoshi. Right down to positioning, you can see the sleeves here. This is a little bit hard to see, but so you can see the edge of the sleeves coming out here, right? It's kind of waterfall shaped. You have these beautiful branches of this flower, the Yugao, which is a flower name, which means evening faces. It's very similar to morning glories. It's the same kind of viney thing, except unlike morning glories, it comes out at night. Right? So the use of this image does a number of intriguing things that set the stage for this story, right? This appears very early on. First, it establishes Tsukiko as a woman with a connection to the moon, right? This series by Yoshitoshi is one of 100 prints in a series called Aspects of the Moon. And every single print illustrates a story associated with the moon. It also establishes Tsukiko as a ghost figure, using this famous ghost print to do so. And it conflates her ghost, Kabuki's mother's ghost, with the ghost of another murdered woman, a woman who was murdered by a ghost. Not of someone who was dead, but of someone who was alive, just as she was murdered by someone who was alive. So if we return to Max Intek's meditation on the nature of ghosts, right? The thing about vengeful ghosts that makes them dangerous is that their passions are out of control. Typically, particularly in the Han period setting of The Tale of Genji and in numerous Noh plays of the Muromachi period, people became vengeful ghosts because they could not let go of some driving passion, either of love or of hate. In the Buddhist sense, this is articulated as an inability to let go of the material world and the things that gratify one within it. But it can also be understood as a situation in which one does not govern their passions, but is instead governed by those passions. And that is really a very key difference between Kabuki and Kai. Both are driven by passion, right? Kai is driven by his murderous sense of outrage that his father would become interested in a lowly, comfort woman, right? And he discriminates and hates everything that's associated with that, right? Kabuki is driven by this need to put her life back together after this terrible, terrible thing that Kai did to her, right? So in that sense, it is Kai and not Kabuki who is the real ghost at the heart of this story. Though they're both haunted by the past and unable to let go of their respective grudges, there's a fundamental rationality about Kabuki's quest to get revenge that is lacking from Kai's pursuit of hate. And visually, as well as narratively, David Mack makes that very, very clear. And so does Shatterboxlet. I hope that you will enjoy very much seeing the show. And I thank you all so much for coming to hear me talk. If you have questions, I'd be happy to answer.
Wow.
How
is that
work?
Sorry.
Wow. That's amazing.
Questions?
But you live in Pittsburgh now?
Yeah, I live in Pittsburgh now. Or no, I don't live in Pittsburgh now, I live in Cincinnati. Cincinnati? Yeah. I saw your hand pop up.
There are the shrines or the statues of the, I don't know if it's a god that sold your children?
Jizo.
Yeah, Jizo. Does that have any relationship to the, I mean, was that ever? know what, if there's a connection or not.
That's a little bit different, because Jizo, of course, is a Buddhist deity, and Ubume are ghosts of people. So there's a little bit of a difference. I think Jizo is kind of his role. He acts as a benefactor for all children, whereas Ubume are usually very specifically focused on their own child. But certainly, I think the way they're treated, there are certain similarities. One of the, you've seen the Jizo statues, the little stone statues, they have like the little knitted hats and the little knitted sweaters that people make for them so that they won't look cold in inclement weather. And so there is a real, again, you see this real sense of this Mononoke concept that I talked about in English. I don't know if you might have missed, but the original idea of ghosts was so broad and encompassed inanimate objects and all those kinds of things. And so there is this profound idea that the image of the thing is the thing. And so a statue of Jizo, Buddha, Bosatsu, is Jizo. Right? It's not a piece of stone. It is a real thing, a real spirit, which is why people go out and they will care for it, because Jizo is an active and public service in the world. I don't think anybody would seek out an Ubume, even with good intentions. Many Japanese people, I think superstition has declined in technological age, but they still make an awful lot of horror films that are about ghosts, so I think they're still framed. Most people, I've seen ghosts. Oh, really? It's a very kind of like, ooh. So there's this idea that they are absolutely to be avoided. And there are places in towns that have uncanny reputations. They report feeling uncomfortable when they walk past certain streets. They don't want to be there. There's a website where you can go if you're interested in real estate. You can look up if anybody's died there, because people want to avoid potentiality of having a haunted house. So it's still, and at least in terms of objects, there is a group of people who their whole job is to take old appliances, vacuum cleaners, washing machines, things like that, which are believed to over time develop a kind of spirit which can become angry when it's abandoned. And so rather than simply throwing it away, they will give it to these organizations who will kind of care for and venerate these objects so that they don't become enraged and do something like that little wine jar that killed the daughter in the mansion for seemingly no reason whatsoever. Yeah.
You can have those sweeps chasing us, right?
Yeah, yeah. Be nice to your groom. One day.
Very, very interesting. Oh my goodness. The Mononoke that I missed that part at the beginning. What was that? When I hear that word, it makes me think of the...
Princess Mononoke.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
my daughter's terrified of that movie.
Well, yeah, because there's all these... Yeah.
Yeah, she's 21, she's still scared of it.
Oh, it's not scary. Screen, and that's all that matters. So yeah, this is the thing I was talking about earlier, which is in the classical period, say about from the 8th century through to the early modern period, this idea of what a ghost actually was very undefined. And the most common expression, the kind of blanket moniker that you had for things, was this Mononoke, which literally means the spirit of things. And there are actually two different ways to spell it. Like, you have mono here, this is just a character for things, just ordinary inanimate objects. Spirit. But this one here is really interesting. This is the original way that it was written, mono no ke, which means things in a much more frightening sense. This is the character Oni, which you'll hear referred to, because the person who issues directives for the no is a character named Oni, who wears a devil mask. And that's what this character here means, Oni. which was read as normal. And so there was a real lack of specificity about what these creatures were that could just kind of encompass any number of things. A dead person who had come back for revenge, or a wine jar that was out and about for a night of mischievous, malevolent fun.
It makes so much more sense now. The explanation of that, not Poe.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much for coming. I hope you, are you seeing the show tonight?
Yes.
You are in for such a treat. It's really wonderful. They've done just a beautiful job of it. Yeah.